Welcome to our last PISA-related panel of this day. I know it'll be a good one. My name is Stephanie Wood-Garnett, and I'm the Vice President of the Policy to Practice team here at the Alliance. Thanks for being here with us this afternoon. I hope that you've enjoyed and found valuable the other panels that we've had today. This morning, we heard from Andrea Schleicher about the 2015 PISA results and the performance of the U.S. This afternoon, with Rick Hanyshek and Linda Rosen, we related these results to the economic changes that can occur with a strong educational system. And during the panel just before this one, three global learning network partners shared their stories about PISA-related OECD tests for schools and its impact on their improvement efforts. Well, we've saved the best for last, and as we broaden our discussions to examine key policy takeaways from the PISA results, to discuss strategies to increase the global competitiveness of American students, and to preview opportunities and challenges. But before we launch this final panel, a few details. Please join the conversation via Twitter using the hashtag, #OECDPISA. You can also ask questions using that same hashtag or via the box below this video window. Today's event will be archived at allfored.org/webinars, and please visit PISAday.org for information on future events on the PISA assessment, our important partner, the OECD, and the Alliance. Thank you also to the Kern Family Foundation for its support of the Alliance's work around PISA. Now let me introduce our guests. Co-facilitating this conversation with me today will be Robert Rothman, who is a senior editor at the National Center on Education and the Economy and a consultant to other educational organizations. Previously, he was a senior fellow here at the Alliance and a senior editor at the Annenberg Institute for School Reform, where he edited the Institute's quarterly magazine, Voices in Urban Education. Bob is also the author of Something in Common, the Common Core Standards, and the next chapter of In American Education and Measuring Up, Standards, Assessments, and School Reform. Thanks for being here today, Bob. We also have here today with us Dr. Mitchell Chester, the Massachusetts Commissioner of Elementary and Secondary Education. From 2001 to 2008, he worked for the Ohio Department of Education, where he was the second ranking educator. Mitchell also served as the executive director of the Accountability and Assessment for the School District of Philadelphia from 1997 through 2001. Prior to working in Philadelphia, he was the chief bureau of the curriculum and instructional programs of the Connecticut State Department of Education. Previously, Mitchell was a teacher, assistant principal, and curriculum coordinator in three school districts. Also great to have you here today.
Thanks, great to be here.
Finally, it's great to have back Maureen McLaughlin. Maureen is a senior advisor to the Secretary of Education and Director of International Affairs at the U.S. Department of Education. She has led and coordinated international activities and engagement and spearheaded the development of the department's first international strategy designed to strengthen U.S. education and advance U.S. international priorities. Maureen also worked at the World Bank as lead education specialist and education sector manager, where she worked with senior officials in Eastern Europe, Central Asia, and Turkey to provide strategic direction and technical leadership for improving education at all levels. Thank you for being here, Maureen.
Thank you for having me.
You can see that we have a very distinguished group for this final panel, and given that, let's dive right into the questions in our discussion.
Thank you, Stephanie, and thanks again, Mitch and Maureen, for being here. Start with Maureen. Why does PISA matter to the United States?
PISA is very important to us. We all want all of our students to be able to achieve at high levels. We want students to come out of high school with the skills and the knowledge to be able to compete globally and to be able to go on to college or have successful careers. And what we see when we look at the PISA results that were just released, we see disappointing results. We see that we've fallen behind in one subject area. We've stayed even in two. At the same time, other countries are going ahead of us. And we really need to be looking at what's happening with other countries, because in a knowledge-based economy, in a globally connected world, jobs are easily move around. They move between states. They move between countries. And if our students can't measure up and compete in a global world, and you can see that we have a long way to go, that's a real problem for us economically, but also just for the lives and day-to-day operations of our students.
Maureen, thanks for that. I think one of the things we also heard this morning during the presentation is that while our performance is not where we perhaps would like it to be at the moment, there have been some bright spots in our performance this year. So one thing we learned is that since 2006, when the socioeconomic status accounted for 17% of the variation in student performance in science, however, the mean performance did not increase over that same period. But we are seeing some increases in equity and the gains that we're making there. Can you speak to, Maureen and Mitchell, some of the things that we can do in the United States to keep making the gains in the equity areas of our performance and also to keep learning with and from other countries and economies?
Sure. Again, it's great to be here, and this morning's presentation was terrific and was very provocative. And I think you hit on one of the core findings. Most of the variation in achievement that we see across OECD nations, within the United States, and certainly with the Massachusetts results, are due to decisions that teachers make in classrooms, the kinds of instructional practices, the kinds of school policies, and students' attitudes in the case of science, towards science. That accounts for the majority, the vast majority of the variation. So it's not largely about students' family background, demographic background, and so forth. That's very encouraging, and to hear some of the strategies that are associated with higher achievement, and some of which are kind of common sense, but to see it laid out in an empirical kind of way reinforces. Are students getting well-designed lessons in science? Are they getting direct explanations about science content, about science concepts? Are teachers making adjustments when students are falling behind or not keeping up with an understanding of a concept? Whether or not students report that that is happening or not happening makes a big difference in whether or not they're doing well or not doing well in science. Those are things that we can replicate across the board.
Very much the focus, and as you talked about the improvement, also the bright piece of the OECD is the improvement on equity, and we're really quite happy about that. That, I think, is a result of a concentrated effort, both at the federal level and at state levels, to really bring everybody up, to improve the quality of low-performing schools, to have high expectations and high standards for everybody. And that really relentless focus on everybody, and meaning all means all, is really important. And that happens in the classroom. That happens with the student, his or herself. That happens at the federal policy level. It happens at the state level. Yesterday, we visited Massachusetts, and a young student talked to us about her experience at Mildred Avenue School. And she said some of the exact same things you just said about when she was asked, why have you found being here at this particular school so helpful for you? Her response is about, the teachers don't leave me behind. If I don't understand something, they describe it another way. My teachers talk to each other. They push me to try something, even if I'm going to fail, because I can try it a second time. So her responses as a young woman about what she felt was really helping her to improve match up to the kind of policy recommendations and the policy steps that other countries take. And I think that's a nice circle to see, that at an individual student basis, you're getting a similar result and a similar feeling about what works as you would at a classroom, at a school level, at a country level.
Mitchell, can you describe a few of the policy changes or policy levers in Massachusetts? Because we heard a lot today about the way in which Massachusetts is leading in this work, and I think our viewers would really appreciate understanding if there are certain things that you have tested and found that are really supporting the work on the ground, so that student experience is what you heard from the young person.
Yeah, I'm going to start by bragging a little, just to be sure those who are tuning in know some of the basic facts. So it was tremendously encouraging to get the PISA results for Massachusetts. We were one of two states that participated independently of the United States. And if we were a nation, we'd be tied for first in the world in reading. Only Singapore would outperform us in science. We'd be behind 10 nations, but ahead of 60-some-odd nations. nations in terms of our math results. So that's very encouraging. I've always known that in Massachusetts, many schools, hardly all schools, but many schools are providing students with a first-class education that's second to none among the education you can get on the globe. Our challenge is how do we make sure that all students are getting that first-class education? And that's something that the Commonwealth has worked hard on over 20 years, more than 20 years of kind of a consistent set of reforms, a consistent framework. And the elements of that framework were fairly simple. It was what's often referred to as a grand bargain. Increased investment dollars in the K-12 system in a very progressive formula, so that school districts that had the least ability to raise their own revenue got a lot more from the state. But in return for that increased investment was an expectation that we would deliver strong instruction and that the results would show. Results matter. And so we've put together a framework of policies that we've upgraded over time over the last 20 plus years based on what we're learning. We're doing more to support our lowest performing schools, becoming more interventionist in the worst of our performing schools to try to boost performance there and having some very good results, certainly not universally good. We have a long way to go. It's a work in progress. But we're also not resting on our laurels. We're examining the aspirations, the expectations, the learning standards that we've set out through our curriculum frameworks, our content standards, and asking are they as high as they can be? And in fact, in the last 2 years, we've been upgrading our science, our literacy, and our math standard as well. And participating in PISA for us is absolutely critical to that initiative. I'd add one thing to Maureen's opening comment. You know, I think that those who watch international systems could make the claim that it's not that the United States has lost ground in terms of the education we're providing, but 30 years ago, 40 years ago, we were at the top of all the nations by most indicators, including the percentage of our population that's college educated. We're now probably 15th, 20th in the world. And that's not us slipping. That's other nations putting more emphasis on their education system and upping their game. So for me in Massachusetts, it's critical that we continue to be on top of our game, that we continue to look at what the most aspirational systems, education systems in the world are aiming toward and make sure that we're aiming at least as high.
I'd like to just reinforce the kudos to you in Massachusetts for the results that you see in PISA that are, as you described, really a long-term sustained effort and attention. And really, that's what we all need to do. So congratulations. And I know you still have more to do, but really quite excellent progress.
No, thank you. And that consistency that in Massachusetts has continued through changes of administration, mm-hmm. through Republican governors, Democratic governors, through changes in leadership in the legislature, to the credit of our elected officials. They've stayed the course, made adjustments, upgraded and refined where we're headed, but have not abandoned that basic framework of reform, and it's paying dividends.
What can PISA tell us about what high-performing countries do? Is it consistent with what Mitch described Massachusetts has done, Maureen?
Yes, quite consistent. I mean, obviously, different countries do different things, but there are some very common themes that cut across the high-performing countries. One common theme is that there's a real system, so that you're really looking at all the different parts of your education system to bring them together, to work together. That's really an important piece. Another is the high expectations and high standards and the resources to help you get to that point. Another, which we cannot underestimate, is teachers. Having high quality, well-prepared teachers and teacher leaders in the schools is absolutely essential. And that's a place where we see, for example, Singapore has paid so much attention to the preparation of their teachers through from the recruitment through to the training once they get in the classroom with mentors in the beginning, continual improvement, multiple career options, so many different pieces that they have really put an enormous focus on teaching being a highly revered profession. If you look at international statistics that show what do people in a country think about teaching as a profession, Singapore scores up at the top. It's a revered profession. The U.S. is in a very different place on those statistics. There's all kind of pieces like that that I think come in. You've put a lot into teacher preparation and teacher professional development. So yes, I think there are common pieces. Each country or each state or each area needs to adapt it to their own circumstances, but you can see some very common themes.
Mitchell, can you share a little bit of what you've been doing? I mean, obviously, Massachusetts has been at this work for a long time, and I think the viewers today would love to hear some of those levers that have really supported that change, particularly as we talk about teacher professionalism, which was a key message this morning from Andreas's presentation.
Yeah, you know, I think we're taking our first steps around teacher professionalism in Massachusetts. It's not that we've ignored that, but I think we're really at the front end of what I hope will be a much more robust, widespread initiative around teacher professionalism. We're looking at what it takes to become a teacher, the preparation programs, the kind of experiences under guidance in your first couple of years of teaching. But we're also looking at opportunities as a teacher to advance, to take on more responsibility, to take on leadership roles, what some would call career ladder kinds of opportunities. So in several of our districts, and I would highlight Lawrence, I would highlight Springfield, I'd highlight Holyoke right now, as three districts where students are heavily impacted by poverty, where we're investing a lot in school-level decision-making and teacher leadership teams and opportunities for teachers to advance more quickly, to take on leadership roles and additional responsibility without leaving the teaching ranks, and to be recognized for that through their compensation. But at the same time, we need to see results. So it is, again, a bargain of we need you to lead, but we also need to see students doing better. And we know we can do better because we're seeing it happening in many of our schools. We need to see it happen in all of our schools.
Now, states are developing plans under ESSA, the Every Student Succeeds Act. What opportunities are there under ESSA for states to develop plans that are consistent with these kinds of practices that Mitch described and you described?
Well, let me talk a little bit, and then you could perhaps talk specifically from Massachusetts. I mean, there's a real opportunity under ESSA for states to define what it means to have a well-rounded education for everybody and how to define the meaningful accountability systems. That's the opportunity that is there for states in developing their plans. When the department provided guidance for Title II for the teacher pieces, there were lots of discussion in that guidance about things that have worked in this country that have been successful to give ideas to states about things they might want to do. In addition, we had at that point the secretary had just returned from a trip to Shanghai and Singapore. So we added online a short piece on what Shanghai and Singapore does with teachers, from preparation to teacher collaboration, peer review, all those kind of things, to give some more ideas of things that have really worked in other places. So the time now is that the states are looking at that and for states to look at what have other high-performing states done, or what have other high-performing countries done. That's a real opportunity to bring that kind of information into the decisions about how to do the plan.
What is your plan going to say?
You know, we're still cooking that plan. It's still on the burner. But you know, one thing that intrigued me with Andreas's presentation this morning was his observation that a strategy that both provinces in China and Japan are using is that they're giving their strongest teachers opportunity to move every 3 or 4 years to schools that are struggling, mm-hmm. and to be part of the turnaround of those schools. That really intrigues me. We often think about how do we get the right principal in that school that's struggling. But that whole talent pipeline, and can we think about cultivating teams of teachers with a principal, with a school leader, who might be ready to come into those tough assignments, those assignments where students are lagging, are not getting the kind of education they deserve, and turn those situations around. So that piece intrigued me quite a bit.
Mm-hmm. Are there other lessons, Mitchell, that you and Massachusetts have learned from the PISA participation that have kind of helped you think about how do we close those gaps between students at our low performance levels with others? What are some of those things that you are learning as a result of your participation that might be helpful to some of our other viewers?
There's a couple of things that are quite provocative in our own state data that in some ways parallel what Maureen described for the United States data. We don't have as long a track record with PISA as a state alone. This is our second administration. So we took it in 2012, this 2015 is the second time. But it's fascinating to me that for the most part our higher poverty schools are where we made the gains. And in fact, our lowest poverty schools, the schools with less than 10% of students qualifying for free and reduced lunch, across the three subjects, lost ground. Mm-hmm. That to me is provocative. I certainly am heartened by seeing schools that are serving a more diverse socioeconomic community making gains. I don't want it to see our stronger schools losing ground. I certainly don't want to see that. So that's an area that I'll be focused on among other data pieces that I'm pulling out of the data. And one of the initiatives that we're investing in is this OECD Test for Schools, PISA for Schools initiative. We've encouraged our high schools to participate this winter in the initiative, and we have between 20 and 30 high schools at this point who have expressed interest. And so I'm hoping that at the school level, with participation, we'll get increased interest in what are the most aspirational schools and educational systems in the world aiming at, and how can we make sure that we're doing the same for our own students.
If I could just follow up, are you seeing the same trends on your state test, or does PISA measure something different that you don't get from your state test?
You know, in a very general directional level, it's not a surprise to me that Massachusetts did well. I mean, on most assessments that we participate in, we come out quite strongly. On the NAEP, the state NAEP, we're at the top. Mm-hmm. So that didn't surprise me. What PISA shows, because we give a 10th grade test in Massachusetts, and on our 10th grade, just to give you a kind of a very general level of the contrast in the expectations between the assessments, on our 10th grade test in both literacy and math, about half of our students are scoring at the advanced level the first time they take that test. On PISA, in those two subjects, the students who are scoring at the top two performance levels, what OECD considers high performers, is below 15%, somewhere around 14% or so. So there's no question that PISA stretches the expectations, the aspirations, the goals for what students can do with what they've learned well beyond what our current state assessment does.
Mm-hmm. So from a national level, Maureen, what is it that you know, we can be thinking about in the U.S. in terms of the lessons that can be applied? We have the benefit of having Mitchell here to hear more about the Massachusetts story, but are there other things from the 2015 data that we should take into account as we think about our plans for ESSA or our plans for improvement in general?
I think one of them is really paying very careful attention to groups who are lower performing. I mean, and really what is happening to the groups that are in the lower performing schools or the lower performing demographics, what is it that needs to happen there? What kinds of things can states do or districts do to really up the quality of the education there? And I think one example that you just gave, Mitch, from China and from Japan, where they take teams of teachers and partner them up with lower performing schools, or sometimes move them. They have a number of different ways that they do it, but they really are partnering lower performing schools with higher performing schools and trying to grow the benefits across the two schools. I think those would be things that would be really interesting for more of that to happen around the United States. When we're talking about the equity issues, you know, I think we can look even within our country. You know, Massachusetts performs, when you are tested by yourself, you perform up there with the top countries and top education systems in the world. If we had those same data for every state in this country, we'd have a very different picture across the spectrum, and that shows that we have the same sort of equity issues across states as we have within states, and that's another piece, I think, that merits a fair amount of attention.
How do we create that interest in our country? I mean, I think one of the conversations this morning was the interest in nationalism and the availability of this kind of international data. How do we create a demand for additional states to want to participate in PISA and also to see the benefit of having those additional models as we think about how to improve education here in the United States?
I'll start. I mean, this concerns me quite a bit. We're experiencing a backlash in this country, and certainly Europe is experiencing it in other parts of the world, against globalization. And I mean, in part, our last election, not wholly, but in part, was a reaction to globalization. Certainly the Brexit vote was, the vote this weekend in Italy. Those weren't the only reasons, but there's no question that there's a pretty widespread kind of anti-globalization sentiment that's at play right now. And it worries me a lot that we shouldn't become parochial, because we're not going to put the genie back in the bottle. We are an interdependent globe. Our economy in Massachusetts very much depends on our ability to interact not only across the nation, but across the globe. We have many companies and research firms that are very dependent on this global economy, and so I do worry that we draw ourselves in and say we don't need to pay attention to what other countries are doing. But I think there's an economic imperative, if nothing else. There's an imperative in terms of the kinds of society we're going to go forward in, and that our children and our grandchildren are going to inherit. And so if we can get that across and make it clear that doing well compared to how we did yesterday is not enough, doing well compared to how states down the road did is not enough, our students' opportunities are going to be less and less confined by the state they grow up in, and more and more determined by how well prepared they are to take advantage of opportunities that are going to be offered globally.
I'd like to reinforce that, because I think some of the view about globalization being a problem and translating into different election results, some of it in cases, I think, focus perhaps on the wrong thing, that it may not be the globalization per se that people were kind of blaming in some cases, but technological change and not having the education and skills to be able to be adapting in that kind of an environment where the job opportunities are quite different. So to me, it really reinforces why we need to care so incredibly much about our students, you know, coming out of high school ready to operate in careers, to be able to go to college, so they have skills and knowledge and ability to be flexible and think critically, to have different kinds of jobs as technology changes, as the job opportunities change, that they really are in a knowledge-based economy that puts, I think, even more and more emphasis on the need for the high-quality, critical thinking kind of education.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And, you know, people often think of Massachusetts as the kind of high-tech, IT, biomedical, kind of maybe second only to Silicon Valley place in the United States. But it's interesting, we have a very robust manufacturing sector in Massachusetts. in a number of areas, including parts for aviation that are produced in the Connecticut River Valley, the Springfield Corridor, Springfield-Holyoke Corridor. More and more, those jobs require advanced kind of mathematical reasoning and computer skills, because students are now, rather than running manually adjusted machining tools, they are running computers that are based on their ability to understand the Cartesian plane, three dimensions, and program those machines to create parts to very high levels of specificity.
Well, one thing that you're talking about these results from a messaging point of view is that it's difficult to make the point that these results are concerning, because we've been basically the same for 15 years. But how do you make the point that's not good enough, because the expectations are now higher to do those kinds of jobs?
Well, again, I'd start with that self-interest. The jobs of the future, the jobs of the present, require that students have advanced reasoning skills, strong literacy skills, strong mathematics skills, understand scientific concepts, are able to read technical material, are able to solve problems that may be unique and novel that they have not seen before. Mm-hmm. These are the kinds of skills that employers are going to look for the jobs that are going to pay the livable wages, the wages where you can raise a family and have a good life. And so we owe it not only to ourselves and the future we're building, in our case in Massachusetts, collectively in the United States, but as well to the young people who are coming through the system, so that they have a shot at the good life. Because without that kind of strong education, there'll be fewer and fewer jobs that pay a livable wage that rely on a lower level of education. So for me, it's a self-interest imperative. It's an ethical and moral imperative in terms of the work we've signed up to do as educators for the young people who we're educating.
So this morning, during Andreas's presentation, we heard a lot about the aspirations of young people in America to actually want to be in the STEM fields, yeah, which was really heartening. But then we also learned that perhaps the way in which we are preparing them is not meeting their aspirations, because perhaps we're not preparing them so that they can do those jobs in the future. So I'd love to hear a little bit about your reflections or thoughts on, at the US level and at a state level, what can we do to improve our science education? How do we reflect on the math results in ways that align the young people's aspirations and help them get those opportunities in the future?
Yeah. A terrific question. And we have a number of initiatives underway in Massachusetts to try to do exactly that. We have a set of STEM initiatives, STEM-focused initiatives, that have several prongs to them. We're trying, for one thing, to capitalize on what is a very strong vocational technical career education sector in Massachusetts, trying to expand students' access to those higher quality programs, and try to promote increased capacity in the programs that are in the STEM areas. We're reaching out to employers. Our governor's taking a very active role in reaching out to employers in STEM fields to ask them to open internship opportunities to high school students, so that they can actually experience and see how the science that they're studying, the computer programming that they're studying, the biology that they're studying, the math that they're studying, how that's being applied in the workplace in some very advanced sectors. Vertex Corporation in Boston stepped up to the plate and made a big commitment, and so there's a big push around internships as well. And then we're trying to create kind of seamless pathways for youngsters, multiple pathways to move through secondary school into post-secondary education, not always 4 years, sometimes 4 years, sometimes 2 years, but with a vocational, future-oriented, often STEM focus to those pathways so that students can experience, get one foot in the world of work while they're studying, see the application of what they're studying, and make decisions about whether they want to pursue that going forward.
That's fantastic. Yeah,
I would really reinforce what Mitch said. It is very much helping people to see how they use these kinds of skills and why they're important. And that comes very much from linking it to jobs, linking it to hands-on kinds of work that they would be doing. I think that's incredibly important. So a high-skilled career and technical education program is a big piece of the future. It can be, you know, a degree after college. It can be a certificate after college. I mean, after high school. It can be all kinds of levels. But helping people understand why it matters that I understand that math concept or what I would actually do with it when I went into a job would be really important. We went and visited a program in Rhode Island on Monday, which was a partnership between the career and technical school with a boat, General Dynamics electric boat company, where they were really starting to work with kids on the training them to become welders and boat builders. And it started with classroom instruction, learning concepts, then moved into simulation, and then to sort of hands-on using of the equipment things. But they'll be coming out, they'll be able to get internships in their senior years, they'll be able to get hired into jobs when they come out. Those kind of partnerships of business with schools, with a real emphasis on the technical and the academic parts of the education, are, I think, very, very critical.
If you look internationally at the high-performing countries, are those programs active and robust there? Is that one reason they might have some success in PISA as well?
So it's interesting. Two of the countries that are always put out there as high-performing in the career and technical education side are Germany and Switzerland. And they do have these very deliberate ties between business and the schools with internships and hands-on work while you're in school and things like that. So yeah, I think there is a lot there. I'm sure you have lots of that kind of work going on in Massachusetts.
Yeah, not as much as we need to have, not as many opportunities as we'd like to have for our young people. But again, this is a work in progress. I mean, my understanding of the two countries that you cited is this is very much woven into the fabric of opportunities for students, where the business sector is very much linked with the education sector as students come up through the grades. We're not there yet, certainly in Massachusetts, in a systematic way. We have many great examples, robust examples, but we're not there yet systematically. That's what we're working on. Mm-hmm.
So this morning we also heard, and in the afternoon session with Linda Rosen, Eric Hanushek, we also discussed a little about the gender differences in the interest in which professions within the STEM field, as well as the actual performance. And so we did talk today about some gender gaps, and I'd love to hear your perspectives on that as well. So at the national level, as well as in Massachusetts, how do we close those gaps and well prepare all of our genders for professions in this area?
I'll start with the national.
Well, I think that's a big issue. I mean, when we look at generally at how girls versus boys do on academic performance, and things, girls tend to actually be ahead. But then when you look in the STEM fields, there are big differences where girls are typically not participating as much or not doing as well. And some of it is helping them to really see, again, what they would do with those skills. Professions that are appealing and that they view that they can be just as competitive in. And that's a big concern, because sometimes what you see about girls not doing as much when they get into high school as they had done before is thinking that the boys are better at it, and that's clearly something that needs to be addressed.
Yeah, it's heartening with the Massachusetts data that in science there is no gap in performance based on gender, and that girls actually, compared to boys in the Massachusetts data, report a greater interest, a greater expectation of going into a STEM field. When it's broken down, more often they're headed into a health medical field, and boys more often are headed into an engineering kind of field. So there's still some gaps there. One piece that was very heartening to me is we've had a pretty substantial gender gap on the reading side, with females reading much more strongly than our boys, our males have been. We made a pretty substantial dent in that gap, narrowing of that gap compared to 2012. Females still read at stronger levels than males in Massachusetts, but we've narrowed that gap pretty substantially.
And how did you do that? Yeah. I mean, our panel right before this session was our three practitioners talking about some of the things they're doing and learning. How would you say Massachusetts has set out to narrow that reading gap?
Yeah, great question. I'm not sure that I have a definitive answer, but there's certainly been more emphasis in the last 4 or 5 years on reading more complex texts, on reading multiple opinions, perspectives on a given topic, and being able to compare and contrast those perspectives, on reading in the content areas and not just in literature. And I think there's been a lot more emphasis on the need to give students instruction and support in reading in the content areas than we've seen previously. So I'd like to think that those foci have been paying dividends. But of course, those have been across the board. It's not as though we only gave those emphases to males. So yeah. Mm-hmm.
So as we think about the panel we just had before this panel, there was also a lot of conversation about the types of professional development that educators doing this work will require in order to really reflect on the PISA results as well as some of the needs that they see in their own student population. So we can talk about the ESSA opportunities under Title II, but I guess I'm wondering in general, are there some good practices that may come from other countries or things that you're lifting up in Massachusetts that we can share?
Yeah, I mean, I'll start with a couple of things that I've been thinking about in terms of Massachusetts. And again, we just got our PISA results, so we're anxious to dig into them more and figure out how they can inform these initiatives. But one thing that I think is has tremendous potential is encouraging departments at the, particularly at the secondary level, middle and high school level, where you have multiple people teaching math, multiple people teaching science, teaching some social studies, English language arts, to do a better job of connecting with each other around what do we expect a student in a biology class, in a physics class, in a chemistry class, what do we expect them to get out of this class, and how do we know whether or not we're succeeding in that regard. And we have high schools that do that quite well, and it's been part of the culture and fabric of those faculty. But we have many schools where it's sort of shut my door and I teach U.S. history the way I do it, and I'm not quite sure how you do it, but whatever you're doing, good luck. And so I think that's important. And then the conversations around those expectations have to be informed. And I'm very high on our participation in PISA in helping to inform those conversations, looking at where are Massachusetts students succeeding, where aren't they succeeding. And as more and more of our high schools participate in the OECD for schools, the PISA for schools, I think that will elevate that conversation as well.
Well, to follow up on that, one thing that Andreas mentioned this morning was that teachers in some of the high-performing countries like Singapore spend less time in classrooms in front of students and have more time to collaborate. And one of the findings in this report was that the variation within schools is much larger than the variation between schools. So how do you find time for teachers to work together so you can reduce that variation?
Terrific.
That's a good question.
And you know, there's a couple of sacred cows that Andreas sort of took on this morning, which are just so provocative, and I don't think we should be dismissive of them. You've identified one of those. We are so enamored with class size as a variable in the United States, And the evidence, including evidence from the United States, says that's not the best place to place your bet, and certainly the PISA results that were unpacked do as well. So one area that we're thinking about is the amount of time our students spend in school. And in the United States, we have one of the shortest school years. That's certainly true in Massachusetts. So one of the emphases we're putting on particularly on our lowest performing schools is increasing the amount of time. But that's not just time for teachers with students. That's time for teachers to spend without students, working together, working on upgrading lessons, working on understanding where students are struggling and looking for other suggestions for how to approach those areas. So we've invested in that in a few different ways. We have a grant that we give to schools, and we emphasize, we give advantage to the lower performing schools, and also in some of our intervention efforts, adding more time as part of the game plan. But again, not just for students, right? It is to free up teachers to spend more time together working on the work. I don't want to lose the opportunity to identify one other sacred cow that Andreas pointed out this morning, which is the whole idea of inquiry-based, student-based, deeper learning versus more what might be called more traditional, more teacher-directed, more direct instruction kind of efforts. And he made the comment that the data that's emerged from this administration supports more teacher-directed, more traditional approaches. When students report that that's what they're experiencing, they tend to be performing more highly. It reminded me of the Jim Stigler videotape studies from 20 or 30 years ago now, perhaps, where we compared math classes in Germany, Japan, and the United States. And the German and Japan math classes looked like much more traditional teaching, a teacher in front of the class, kids in rows, teacher using the black chalkboard, and in the U.S. classes were more likely to look like more inquiry-based students working together. And at that point in time, German and Japanese students were just well outperforming U.S. students. I just think it's so important that when the data is counterintuitive, we need to pay attention, right? It's not definitive, but we can't be dismissive of it.
Mm-hmm. I think you're right. I mean, I think that perhaps what we heard today is also just a reminder that when we are thinking about teaching and learning, that all of the educators have to have a variety of tools and approaches, and they're sometimes teacher-directed, sometimes teacher-facilitated, sometimes student-directed, but there is no one approach that is best. It's teachers have content, and sometimes that's the best approach. But I did find that very interesting as well, and looking forward to digging into the report.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah, I walked away from some of those discussions that Andreas has had on that particular issue. Mm-hmm. And with really, it's not an either or. And
right.
That's how I walked away.
Yes.
Is it's not either you do it totally teacher-directed or totally inquiry-based. It's a combination. And then in some sense, he was pointing out that some of the countries that you think are more one or the other don't actually match up when you look at the data more carefully. So to me, it's really that it's a balance and not an either or kind of a discussion. That's what I took away from much of that. I want to come back to one of your other points, which is the time for collaboration for teachers, because that is, when you look at the TALIS data, for instance, on teachers, that's an area where there are enormous differences between the United States and many of the high-performing countries. And, one statistic that I have here is that, nearly a half of teachers in the United States said they had never observed a classroom or provided feedback to one of their co-teachers. And that's compared to 1% in Shanghai and 20% in Singapore. That's only one very small piece of what collaboration is, but that would say that most teachers really don't know what's going on in another class if they've never sort of worked with them or observed with them or provided feedback. that is an area where I think we could learn a lot, not just for STEM. I mean, you were talking about it with STEM. It is working across
Absolutely.
The classes for STEM, but working across the classes for lots of other areas.
Absolutely.
And then the time for collaboration for lesson planning and things like that, that's another big area for collaboration. But the just that one statistic says to me that people are really not in, in classrooms seeing what each other are doing or learning from each other.
Yeah, absolutely. Those are sobering statistics.
Mm-hmm.
So Mitch, what would you tell your fellow chiefs about your experience with PISA, and how might you convince more states to take part next time?
Yeah. You know, first of all, I would start with the argument I've made earlier in this web broadcast about it's in our interest in Massachusetts. It's in your interest in Oklahoma. It's in your interest in Idaho, in 50 states, to make sure that you're preparing young people for the world they're going to enter, and knowing that fewer and fewer of the strong opportunities for those young people are going to be limited by geography or political boundaries. And we are a globally dependent world, and so PISA gives you a chance, gives us a chance, to get feedback not only on our performance relative to others, but a lot of insights into the policies and practices, because the PISA surveys of teachers that go along with this, parents, administrators, provide the opportunity to look at what differences in teaching approach, what differences in school policy, what differences in parent attitudes make a difference in achievement, and most of that is actionable. So few of this is dependent on students' background. I have a pet peeve that I'm going to air here. There's an article in the Boston Globe this morning about our results, and one of the commentators said, "Well, it's not surprising that Massachusetts did well. It's a strong economy. People make good money, and it's a highly educated population." Well, I think that's being dismissive. I really do. As I noted earlier, one of the counterintuitive pieces to me was, while our results from 12 to 15 stayed quite strong, we actually, in our least poverty schools, our lowest poverty rate schools, actually lost ground. And in most of our schools that had higher levels of poverty, we actually gained ground, which I don't want to see us lose ground at any level.
Right.
But the fact that, but that tells me that this is a much more complex story than what is the background of your students, the family background. And I worry a lot that more and more from teacher leadership in Massachusetts, I hear that test scores don't matter, that they don't tell as much. We know it's all about the kids' background. And I absolutely reject that. Mm-hmm. I think that as educators, we have the ability to change the outcomes and the life chances for our young people. I think the PISA results internationally, nationally, as well as for Massachusetts, demonstrate that. That's very hopeful.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Very hopeful.
Yeah. And Andreas demonstrated that this morning by making it very clear in his presentation that disadvantage does not equate with destiny, right?
Mm-hmm.
So
that's right.
What do we do next, you know, as we think about, Maureen, taking the data, all getting to go home tonight and really dig deeply into it, how do we act upon the opportunities to learn about the equity closing activities that some of the countries and economies highlighted this morning have really taken advantage of?
Can I come back to one thing that Mitch was saying about participating as a state? And you know, you described what the benefits are to you. I feel that when a state participates, you're able to do the analysis much closer to the policies that are going on. And so the kinds of things that you're talking about, digging more deeply into the data at a state level where you know what kinds of policies have been really happening in that smaller jurisdiction,
right,
than the country, you can do a much deeper look at what you're doing and how it's impacted and what you might want to change at that state level by participating.
Right.
It's harder at the national level because to make all of, we can make broader policy conclusions, but we're covering the entire country in mm-hmm. in the PISA sample. The sample is relatively small, so it's harder to get into that more granular look that I think you are already starting to do in Massachusetts, and that's a benefit to a state to be able to do that. We did propose several years in a row, but it was never funded, a proposal in our appropriations bill that we, if states wanted to participate, that we would share the cost with states to participate in PISA up to a certain number of states and a certain amount of money. That didn't ever pass, but it reflected that we certainly felt that it was beneficial for states to be able to participate in PISA if they could, and understanding that it does cost money.
But you do have some responsibilities at the national level and federal level. So what would you say to the next administration about what these results suggest about what they ought to do?
Okay. And I wasn't saying we don't have any responsibility, but that we can't get to the granular level mm-hmm. that you can at a state level in terms of the national. A couple things I would say. That the things that we have seen both high-performing states and high-performing countries do, there are really some very common messages. We don't know what the next administration will have as their priorities, but things like high expectations and high standards, clearly that pays off. Meaningful accountability that matches up to those high expectations and high standards. A continued and relentless focus, so not, you know, that you, it takes a long time, this doesn't happen overnight. Focus on the quality of the teachers. Again, from the early stages of recruiting through to the entire career of teachers. Those are things that I would say are really important messages that you get from looking at the PISA data and the states and in your case, Massachusetts, and the high-performing education systems that say, regardless of you know, whether you're a Republican administration or a Democratic administration, those are super important things to do that will pay off.
You know, I'd add one caveat to that, Bob. It's it seems to me that there has been a through line of federal policy, probably going back to the Johnson administration, the passage of the Elementary and Secondary Education Act, through both Bush presidencies, the Clinton administration, the Obama administration. A through line that builds on figuring out, being clear about what you expect of students, and we've had our arguments about to what extent the federal government should be in that area, but I don't think too many people argue with being clear, measuring against that, holding people accountable, reporting results, making it transparent. And I just hope that as the new administration comes in, they figure out how to put their own imprint on that through line without blowing up the through line. And I do hope that that's the outcome as the Trump administration gets seated and mm-hmm. our secretary nominee takes over.
Mm-hmm. Well, we have run out of time, and this has been an incredibly thoughtful discussion. I want to thank my co-facilitator, Bob Rothman, and our panelists, Mitchell Chester and Maureen McLaughlin. Please keep in mind that today's event will be archived on allfored.org/webinars, and be sure to visit PISAday.org for information on future events on PISA, the OECD, and the Alliance. And once again, we wish to thank the Kern Family Foundation for its generous support of the Alliance's work around PISA. I'm Stephanie Wood-Garnett for the Alliance for Excellent Education. Thanks for joining us for this panel and for our PISA-focused day.